I think it's got to be James Kelman, because he's wayward and dangerous and reckless, and the only one who's interesting. The rest of them are very intelligent, but they're books. Are you interested in them? Did you read them? Did you like them?
Either Margaret Atwood or Rose Tremain, I think that reflects the great strength of women's writing at the moment, and that is shown in the shortlist, which has three very good women writers on.
I think it's the least impressive shortlist for a long time. The big money says that Kazuo Ishiguro should win. The shrewd money says that John Banville should win. But I say that Rose Tremain should win because hers is the most readable book of the lot.
Well, I think it's a very good shortlist. I think all the authors deserve to win this year. I think Ishiguro probably will win. But I'd really love to see Rose Tremain win it because I think Restoration is a marvellous book. It's a sentimental education of a single character and it really works.
Well, it's a slightly sick-making occasion, isn't it? All these writers dressed up and looking very rich and glamorous when the case is the opposite. However, tonight I'm going for the Ishiguro, which I liked very much when I first read it, that I'd have thought that the John Banville and the Margaret Atwood have a very good chance too.
Very difficult this year, but I think that I would like Margaret Atwood for all her achievement over many years. Kaz Ishiguro, because I think that this particular book is so well-crafted. But I'm going to go for a dark horse, James Kelman, fellow Scot.
And welcome to the 1989 Booker Prize for Fiction, coming live from the Guildhall in London. Here, tucking into their Hebridean salmon, are writers, publishers, agents, and figures from the literary and business worlds, including six guests who might be forgiven for having problems with their digestion, since in less than an hour's time, they'll be hearing news which could make them £20,000 the richer. Add to that the estimated 30,000 to 60,000 extra hardbacks they'll sell, not to mention foreign rights and paperback sales, and you have what is not only the most lucrative award in the British literary world, but also the most prestigious, gaining the winner entry to a club that includes William Golding, Nadine Gordner, Iris Murdoch, and Salman Rushdie. To apply for membership of this club, all you have to do is be a citizen of the Commonwealth, Ireland, or South Africa, and have written a novel published in Britain this year. Many are called, but few are chosen. This year, the five judges read 102 books, no doubt many of them more than once, to come up with an initial shortlist of 16, which last month was honed down to just six. As usual, the choice provoked bitter dispute about who was excluded and why. But then controversy is exactly what the Booker feeds on. A unique event in the cultural calendar, it has succeeded in marrying high art to soap opera, which brings us to the six finalists. Margaret Atwood is a Canadian novelist and something of a feminist heroine. She was shortlisted for the Booker in 1986 with The Handmaid's Tale, and her new novel is Cat's Eye. John Banville is the literary editor of the Irish Times, with eight previous novels, including a trio of fictional biographies of eminent scientists to his name. His novel this year is The Book of Evidence. Sybille Bedford has lived much of her life in Europe and has written a number of novels based on her experiences. She is the author of a two-volume biography of Aldous Huxley, and her shortlisted book, Jigsaw, is her first novel for 20 years. Kazuo Ishiguro was born in Nagasaki, but has lived most of his life in England. In 1986, his book, An Artist of the Floating World, was shortlisted for the Booker, and this year, his novel is The Remains of the Day. Rose Tremain teaches creative writing at the University of East Anglia and was a judge on the Booker panel last year. Her Booker entry is called Restoration. And finally, James Kelman, who declined his invitation to attend tonight's dinner. Much of Kelman's writing concentrates on Glasgow lowlife. His shortlisted novel is A Disaffection. So much for the authors. Just as important, of course, are the judges, as last year, a heavyweight literary team with not a token common reader to be seen. The chairman of the judges is David Lodge, a former academic and author both of guides to literary theory and a series of highly acclaimed campus novels. One of these, Nice Work, was on last year's Booker shortlist. Maggie G is a novelist whose last novel, Grace, based on the murder of anti-nuclear campaigner Hilda Morell, was published last year and was considered for the Booker shortlist. Helen McNeil lectures at the University of East Anglia and specialises in women's writing. She is the author of a recent biography of Emily Dickinson. David Profumo is a reviewer for the Sunday Times, the Daily Telegraph and the Literary Review. His first novel, Sea Music, was published last year. And Edmund White is an American writer of novels, essays and short stories, whose semi-autobiographical novel, A Boy's Own Story, has become a bestseller. He has lectured at Yale and Johns Hopkins universities, but he now lives in Paris. So, those are the novelists and their judges. The Late Show now brings you its own portrait of the six shortlisted books and their writers.
James Kelman's A Disaffection is a grimly humorous portrayal of a week in the life of a Scottish schoolteacher as he contemplates resignation, unrequited love and political despair through bleak walks in the Glasgow rain.
In the sense that all that's really just about storytelling, about your own people in a way, without being parochial or without being xenophobic. You write about your own people because that's your own culture. And it has the most truth for you. It's the most concrete, it's the most detailed.
It's about a school teacher, someone who's hitting 30 and is basically disenchanted and disillusioned and disaffected with the work that he does and the existence that he has and the way things are and are not around about him. I think it could be anyone in the social services. I think it's quite particular in some ways to somebody who works within the social services and who believes that political change is necessary, but at the same time is forced to work within something that seems to be part of the establishment.
Now then, I want you all to repeat after me. The present government, in suppressing the poor, is suppressing our parents.
The smiling faces.
The present government is suppressing the poor, is suppressing our parents.
Fine. Smashing. Good. Right then. One more. Animi aegistis. Immediate translation. Ian.
Is it to do with poverty of the mind, sir?
Yes, sir. Now, class. The lot of ye repeat after me. Our parents, who are the poor, are suffering from an acute poverty of the mind.
The smiling faces.
When Guy embarked in his black period, what must he have been thinking on? There he was, 50 years older than Pat Doyle and stuck fast in quicksand.
If you're involved in contemporary art, and literature's a contemporary art form, then you'll read work by contemporary artists. And if the contemporary artists are writing work like mine or like Tom Leonard's or Alistair Gray or Cathy Acker or writers from, say, parts of Africa or the West Indies or parts of America, then this is where contemporary art is, because this is a state of contemporary life. This is what people, contemporary artists, will be involved in. I mean, they don't run away from what's going on. You have to stand up and actually face it as an artist and cope with it if you're writing. And just now in Britain, there's an awful lot of bad things to cope with.
Margaret Atwood's Cat's Eye is the story of Elaine Risley, a successful painter who, from the vantage point of approaching middle age, looks back at her own growing up, both as a woman and as an artist in post-war Canada.
One of the things that Cat's Eye talks about is how truly horrible little girls can be towards each other.
Well, and some people have said, does this mean that you think little girls are worse than little boys? And the answer, of course, is no. It's just that the book is about little girls, and I think their methods are different. Little boys, I think, the action is much more overtly physical. They will beat each other up, and the lines between...
Whereas with girls, it's mind games.
It's mind games, it's manipulation.
Grace is waiting there, and Carol, and especially Cordelia. Once I'm outside the house, there's no getting away from them. They're on the school bus, where Cordelia stands close beside me and whispers into my ear. Stand up straight. People are looking. Carol is in my classroom, and it's her job to report to Cordelia what I do and say all day. They're there at recess and in the cellar at lunchtime. They comment on the kind of lunch I have, how I hold my sandwich, how I chew. On the way home from school, I have to walk in front of them, or behind. In front is worse, because they talk about how I'm walking, how I look from behind. Don't hunch over, says Cordelia. Don't move your arms like that. They don't say any of the things they say to me in front of others, even other children. Whatever is going on in secret, among the four of us only. Secrecy is important, I know that. To violate it would be the greatest, the irreparable sin. If I tell, I will be cast out forever.
I kept wondering with great personal anguish why we let it happen.
I think because children are children and they're innocent, and they have not yet realized that children think that everything that happens to them is normal, and that that is the way life is. So if this is happening to them, it must be the way life is. And it's not until they become adults and they realize that other people have other ways of living their lives that they realize that they had a choice.
And one of the ways in which the book has been read is as a rather sardonic commentary on a certain sentimentality in feminist circles about female friendship. You show that power, competitiveness, envy, and hurt are as built into female friendships as into male. Is that a fair extrapolation of this story?
Sort of fair, or let us put it this way. Why should women be gooder than men? Why should we even expect them to be gooder? I think expecting women to be more angelic than men is simply putting yet another impossible burden upon them. Women are human beings.
Restoration by Rose Tremain is the story of Merivale, a failed physician who is taken into the court of Charles II. The book traces Merivale's journey from foolishness to self-understanding through his immersions in the purgatory of a Quaker bedlam.
The choice of period isn't arbitrary, and it isn't escapist. It seemed to me that there were some quite interesting parallels between our own time and the period of the Restoration. I don't know how far you can push them, but I think they exist. The most interesting one is perhaps the narrowing down of aspiration. There was at that time a focus on Whitehall and the activities of the king. It was as if the king and the palace and everything that flowed from there mesmerized people, as if they could look in no other direction but that direction. And I'm not suggesting that now we're mesmerized by a central character or a central point, but I think we are all mesmerized by the same thing, and the thing we're mesmerized by at the moment is money. Having not stumbled upon this age, but deliberately chosen this age, it seemed to me to be entirely right for the story that I wanted to tell, that I had to have the man as my central character, and that indeed in the early section of the book that he had to be a very unpromising hero, in fact a kind of anti-hero, if you like. I think that my hope is that he gains the reader's sympathy because we laugh at him.
I will now tell you that it had become my daily habit to sing a little to my Indian nightingale. I have no voice at all, and so flat do the notes come out that Minette, in her brief life, used to howl and whimper the moment I opened my mouth, as if I was some desert dog from the land of Mar. But my lack of talent notwithstanding, I love singing. I hear the right notes in my head. The fact that I can seldom attain them distresses my listeners, but doesn't seem to upset me in the least. I am, in this respect, like a man trying to fling his body over a five-barred gate, and no matter how spirited his run already, his heart finding himself at each attempt still on the wrong side of it, and yet filled with joy at his efforts. Finn had told me to play the oboe to the bird, and I had sent to London for one of these instruments, but in the meantime, I sang to it, rather quietly so as not to affront it. And it regarded me watchfully, moving its tail up and down and letting fall onto the painted base of the cage tiny filaments of shit.
John Banville's The Book of Evidence is the dreamlike prison monologue of Freddie Montgomery, a man charged with the seemingly motiveless kidnap and murder of a young housemaid in Ireland.
I wanted it to have the immediacy of a newspaper report, but I also wanted it to have the immediacy of a voice speaking, an inexorable voice that you could not stop listening to. In a way, when you read the book, you think that it's about violence and about evil and about the things that you described. To me, I think it's more about loss and about anguish and about the kinds of things that Freddy, and I always think of him as poor Freddy, I'm rather fond of him, although he was very, very wicked, about all the things that he has lost by a crime which he doesn't understand.
You must let me go, she said, or you will be in trouble. It's not easy to wield a hammer in a motor car. When I struck her for the first time, I expected to feel the sharp, clean smack of steel on bone. But it was more like hitting clay or hard putty. The word fontanelle sprang into my mind. I thought one good bash would do it. But as the autopsy would show, she had a remarkably strong skull. Even in that, she was unlucky.
I like to think that what it has is a sort of hallucinatory extra reality, that things have become so real. I think of art in a way as concentrating on an object until it begins to glow, until it begins to blush. It's almost a sexual approach to objects. And objects can be, I suppose it's a dangerous thing to say, but in a book, objects are stones, rocks, flowers, people. They really, as far as the authorial mind trying to bring that intensity out of them, people and objects are the same thing. Now this, again, is a very dangerous and strange implication. It's part of what this book is about. He will describe, as I say, a sky or a scene from a window with as much intensity as he will describe a person.
Jigsaw is the semi-autobiographical story of a young woman coming to an understanding of the world in the years between the wars. Much of its narrative is set in the south of France.
The omens held. It was a good summer, my third in the south of France. There were many to come, each definable still. Different, individual in atmosphere, focus, events, men and women in foreground. The great constant was the climate. The inflexible summer climate of the Mediterranean coast. It embraced, contained our existence. The ever-present sun and sea, the scented air, the strident sounds of tree frog and cicada were the element we moved in. From May to October there was no rain, only night dew, thus nothing changed. The earth was monochrome, the sea reverberated the sky. Morning after morning we woke to clear light, coolness modulating through the hours into the still, unwavering heat of noon, the small evening breezes, the warm night, luminous from sky and phosphorescent sea. How permanent they felt, these even summers. How reassuring. This will go on. We shall go on.
Yes, how reassuring they felt, and it was like that, and we did not go on. We, not only the characters in the novel, but the world, moving inexorably towards the next war. I think it's exactly what the subtitle says. The subtitle says an unsentimental education. And the education is really a growing creature, I mean, first a child and then an adolescent, learning about the world and learning about human relationships is the story, not so much of the narrator. The narrator is the medium whose eyes it's seen and recollected in maturity, but the story of several marriages and human relationships, one of which the most important one is the one of the narrator's mother and stepfather. But there are all these parallels, and hence the title Jigsaw, because in the end they fit into some kind of pattern, which is that behavior is irrational, grows out of character, that these people are all put in the same situation insofar as it all happens between the two wars. And they've all been, one way or another, deeply affected by the First World War. And now they think they're free, they've come up for air, they can breathe. I mean, life begins again. And yet, we know that went towards the next catastrophe. But they do it already in their own lives, they destroy their own lives, or their own characters. And the story of the narrator, it's really not the story of the narrator, it's the story of these people, seen through somebody who develops and is perhaps quite bright intellectually but completely unversed in emotional realities.
In Kazuo Ishiguro's The Remains of the Day, an aging butler looks back over his life, romanticising the English aristocracy as it disappears around him.
The book is about an aging butler, and he's narrating in the 1950s during a little motoring trip he is taking through England, probably the first such holiday he has ever taken in his life. And this gives him, for the first time in his life, a chance to think. And he spends a lot of time trying to tell himself that his life has not been a waste, that he really did become a great butler. But as the book goes on, what unfortunately for him, the thing he has to face is that the man he devoted his life to was not such a great man. He in fact, was a Nazi collaborator. And worse still, in his out of this strange idealism to be the perfect butler, he turned himself into something almost less than human, something like an emotional eunuch.
It is my impression that our generation was the first to recognize something which had passed the notice of all earlier generations, namely, that the great decisions of the world are not, in fact, arrived at simply in the public chambers, or else during a handful of days given over to an international conference under the full gaze of the public and the press. Rather, debates are conducted and crucial decisions arrived at in the privacy and calm of the great houses of this country. What occurs under the public gaze with so much pomp and ceremony is often the conclusion, or mere ratification, of what has taken place over weeks or months within the walls of such houses. To us, then, the world was a wheel, revolving with these great houses at the hub, their mighty decisions emanating out to all else, rich and poor, who revolved around them. It was the aspiration of all those of us with professional ambition to work our way as close to this hub as we were each of us capable.
Those, then, are the six books. Just as conscientious as Ishiguro's butler in the discharging of their duties are the booker judges, who each year wrestle with over 100 books, and occasionally with each other, to produce a shortlist that at least some critics find a travesty of literary justice, and this year proved to be no exception. We spoke to a number of former booker judges about what exactly goes on behind those closed doors, and we eavesdropped on this year's panel, who made their final decision earlier today.
The booker judges themselves are chosen by a management committee of academics, critics, and representatives of booker. Each year, the committee selection of the great and the good from the literary world are called upon to cut through the swathes of books entered by publishers. Their task is simple and daunting, to pick the finest novel published this year.
They usually start later than us, don't they?
The judges are, I think, the heroes and heroines of the prize. They do a remarkable job and give up a lot of time for not all that much money. That very often makes them feel that the reason they've been chosen is to represent something. There's a cause to represent. And that is not usually the reason they have been chosen.
It's one of the very few places anymore, one of the very few arenas in which the gurus of the literary world actually try to share their judgments, and one of the very few places where they find that their judgments are really very much at odds with each other.
The judges are chosen because they are known to be people who are able to put their viewpoint and strongly believe in certain kinds of books. And it doesn't happen that they're willing to give up those preferences. There is anger, you know, there's anger and disappointment.
This year, surprise, surprise, there was trouble again. One of the most hyped books of 1989 never made it to the final six. For many, it was a staggering mistake.
Martin Amis, in his very first novel, misquoted his father about nice things being nicer than nasty things and suggested that nasty things had a lot to be said for them. And I think that it's that quality in his writing, that nasty things have quite a lot to be said for them, and in the writing of other, often women writers in this last decade, that has made him this year's sacrificial victim.
I think Martin Amis's Land and Fields is a remarkable book. I think it poses all sorts of difficulties for this particular mixture of judges, and I can understand what those difficulties are. But I must say I'm delighted to see it bounding up the bestseller list this year, and I think Martin is probably, you know, one of the three or four major writers of his generation.
I think it's extremely disappointing that he's not been included. Extremely disappointing. It seems to me to show a kind of lack of nerve, or maybe a kind of hostility. People say that there's some kind of feminist antagonism to Amis. I would find that very strange.
A great many women writers, I'm sure, in the past have been excluded because of sexism. And indeed, what I was saying earlier about the tendency to not want aggressive, difficult, problematic books automatically has excluded quite a lot of the most difficult women's writing of the past decade, when Booker has coincided with whole new waves of women's writing, which are precisely that, which are being difficult, quarrelsome, inventive in ways that are not easily assimilable. I think that the fact that we're so worried that Martin Amis has been excluded is itself an example of sexism. Though his book, this particular book, London Fields, does fall into the category I'm talking about. It is a book which is aggressive, untidy, in moral ways, if you like, and therefore the kind that the judges on the whole will be wanting to avoid.
Of course, no Booker shortlist or prize winner can hope to please everyone. The question no one, even the judges, seem able to agree on is who the books are chosen for. Is it to satisfy a literary elite or to attract that most mythical of figures, the common reader?
When I chose a book for literary quality, one of the things I'd have in mind is who is going to read this book. And if I thought that a book was written for an elite, for some clique, for a tiny minority, then it wouldn't for me have literary quality of the kind I wanted. But when you say for the common man, so he can pick it up and read it at the airport, not necessarily. So that because it's won the book, he might then pick it up at the airport, he wouldn't otherwise have done, and would find something new that would actually extend his notion of what writing was. That's what I would like.
I thought the chairperson in my year had a very low opinion of the common man and wasn't looking for a book he admired, but for a book he felt that the people he represented admired. It's proved in terms of sales of Booker novels, unless we think people are so quixotic that they buy in very large numbers books they're not going to read, that in fact the so-called common reader is capable of enjoying, or at least being interested by, rather improbable and challenging kinds of books.
I've never known a prize that didn't have controversy around it. And the arguments about books are usually arguments not just about literature, but about values, about political directions, and so on. These are very important things that are happening. Books focus a lot of other energies and activities that are going on in culture, which is why they're so important. And it doesn't worry me a bit that there's, you know, there have been a good many rows around the book. And there always have been, as far back as I can remember. The first one infuriated me like anything when John Fowles wrote the best book of the year, The French Lieutenant's Woman, didn't even get on the shortlist. I was angry then, and I've been, you know, engaged and often dismayed by the Booker ever since.
A look behind the judging process, a job which can often be rather thankless, particularly when live television puts the right name to the wrong face, which is what we did just a few moments ago, a mistake we now put right. This is the real Maggie G. Well, in the month that the judges have spent rereading the shortlist of six, the bookies have been busy cleaning up on what has become a staple feature of the gambling year. And waiting to give me the closing odds is Ron Pollard of Ladbrokes, who, along with the judges, reads the Booker shortlist every year and, on the basis of his opinion, draws up the odds that open the betting. Ron, from what we've got here, it looks like we've got a neck-to-neck finish tonight.
Well, we've got joint favourites tonight, the Ishiguro and the Banville. We can't split them. They're both 2-1 chances, with the Tremain, a very good chance of Tremain with Restoration, a 7-2 chance. Sybille Bedford with Jigsaw, 7-1. And then Margaret Atwood and Kelman, the two outsiders, at 8-1. But they could all win.
Now, what kind of change have we seen? I seem to remember that when betting opened, Kazuo Ishiguro was still pretty high up there, and Banville was pretty high too.
Well, Ishiguro was 13-8 to begin with. Banville, we offered 3-1 about, and the punters fancied that. So the punters have made Banville a 2-1 chance from 3-1, and Ishiguro has drifted from 13-8 to 2-1.
Now, I've heard it said that betting hasn't been so good this year. Is that true?
You're absolutely right. It's been like trying to sell snow to Eskimos. It's been very, very slow.
Briefly,
I don't know
do you
why.
Think that's because it wasn't such a good shortlist, or we're just losing interest?
No, I don't think that. There isn't an inspirational book this year.
Ron Pollard, what a provocative way to finish. Thank you very much. Since the one thing we can't show you tonight is what the judges themselves had to say about the shortlist, what we now offer you is the next best thing. The Late Show's own hand-picked panel of independently minded critics giving their views. In the chair, the novelist Howard Jacobson.
Good evening. Is the Booker Prize male or female? I ask this only because it is his or her 21st this year, and I would like to wish the party girl or party boy a happy birthday. Perhaps it's hermaphrodite, or has it, under the velvet fist in an iron-gloved chairmanship of David Lodge, been neutered? Certainly this 21st birthday has so far been an emasculate affair. In accordance with Lodge's scout-masterly insistence on secrecy and loyalty, there have been no indecorous fallings out among the judges, with a single sadistic exception when one of the judges went into print and teased hopeful novelists with her personal opinions of them. There have been no unseemly breaches of confidentiality. And there has been less public outcry about the six novels selected than is usually the case. In the main, it seems to be the verdict of literary editors that this year's shortlist is okay. In what has otherwise been a lurid literary year, such acquiescence strikes me as eerie. Has the energy that has gone into lampooning Iris Murdoch, Margaret Drabble, and the rest of the old guard recently drained us of all other passions? Have we learnt to live with the absurdity of expecting six major novels annually, the inevitable injustices and overestimations implicit in any prize, and made peace with what is bound to be arbitrary? There is life after Booker for many a writer who isn't honoured by it. The publicity for these six novels is also a sort of publicity for novels in general. Most novelists are looking plumper than they used to, so what the hell? Or could it simply be that this year's shortlist really is okay? With me to decide on this and perhaps to pick a winner before the judges do are Germaine Greer, writer and publisher, Hermione Lee, teacher and critic, Adam Mars-Jones, writer. I thought we would start with the Kelman, because the Kelman is not the usual sort of book that we expect to find on a Booker shortlist. All power to the Booker elbow for that. But the price we seem to be paying for this unusual book struck me as a maundering, not unlike, I thought, being in the company of a Scots drunk, Billy Connolly without the philosophical ambitions or the jokes. Lots of little woes. How did you cope, Hermione Lee, with the little woes?
Well, I think your vision of
the wee woes.
I think your vision of this year's Booker Prize is a sort of affair of neutered decency. It doesn't quite fit in with James Kelman's book, which is certainly not neutered or decent. I don't think there are any two ways about this book. You are either going to want to go away and throw up, or you are going to read on with a sort of passionate amazement. On the whole, passionate amazement just about wins out.
I think the amazing thing about it was to find on roughly page 185 that he loves the job that he spent the previous 185 pages telling us he hated. Which is being a teacher. And I thought, too, it was a great insult to Scotland's education system, which is remarkably good. I mean, if you're going to choose any element of Scotland as rotten, then education is not what you'd choose. So I had difficulty with the fact he seemed to decide that the world was rotten, and saying so made it so. There was no analysis in it. It was a nervous breakdown as an indictment, and I didn't get that at all.
I thought the extraordinary thing about it was that it hated the reader. I mean, the reader had to take a fantastic pounding. There's a villain called a bourgeoisie, which I imagine means a bourgeois, middle-class person. Who buys novels of this size and this price who is not a middle-class person? And yet everything about middle-class people was presented as utterly indefensible.
No.
Besides, is it a nervous breakdown, or is it simply the result of alcoholic poisoning? It's just constantly sucking up quantities of booze. They're always sitting in pubs. It's as boring as sitting in
and
a
the,
pub.
And the philosophical mentions of are artificial. I mean, it's full of faux naivety. We have something like, we're told that Pythagoras, let's talk about Pythagoras. He's effing interesting, isn't he?
It is crude.
And against eating beans.
It is crude and it is naive, but I don't think one could be sort of snobbish and haughty about it and say, oh, it's frightfully pretentious to mention.
Let's not.
Words, doty, toty, clatty, those wonderful words, yes. All of them about basic things, which do sound fresh and give the page a bit of zing.
With that Glaswegian poetry ringing in our ears, let's go quickly to Canada and Margaret Atwood, a writer you actually appear on the cover of this Admiring, and I too think it's a terrific book, though I wonder about the number of exposed nerve endings. I wonder about the offered sensitivities to everything, to smell, to taste. Is all that quite so necessary?
I had difficulty with this book because I think Margaret Atwood is an extraordinary writer at a particular level. She has a sardonic, crisp, crackling way of summing up situations very quickly. There's a marvellous bit about her reconciliation with her husband, that they went through the reconciliation and straight into deadlock, which is true. I mean, she says things like, and you think, oh, thank God, we could have had, 45 pages explaining how the reconciliation didn't work, but you don't. But I thought the novel was too big and too baggy, and it dragged down the play of that wit until you became, about two-thirds of the way through, I was completely becalmed.
Were you becalmed?
I felt the feeling was consistently worked up to a sort of artificial hysteria. The way the character as a young woman peels away her fingertips, peels away at her lips. I didn't really believe, particularly when the thing she seemed to be agonising about was when she's eating turkey wing, she's eating a lost flight.
Oh, God.
As if, once again, that the emotion was far in excess of the situation that was supposed to generate.
I mean, is there emotion? I just thought that was one of those. That was cute, wasn't it? That was like the alphabet soup spilling onto the acute conceit.
There is a deal of that. I felt she turns into a painter. She could have turned into anything in a way. Yeah, I didn't feel that the past and future fed into each other in a meaningful way, or that they were an antithesis. It could have been all set in the past.
I think you're all leaving out the main thing, the main strength, the main power of the book, which is actually an attack on feminism, your kind of feminism, as a matter of fact, interestingly enough. I mean, what you've got here is a very bold and startling thing, which is a feminist heroine, which Margaret Atwood is, undoing the whole feminist history of the last 40 years and saying that the paintings of this famous artist don't come out of, as the trendy Toronto gallery perceives them, a sort of ideological, optimistic feminist programme. They come out of this terrible, awful thing that's happened to her as a child.
I feel that too. Let's move then to Tremain, to Rose Tremain, which is called Restoration. And I take it that's a clue to us that we know that we are dealing with a restoration of another kind, an internal emotional restoration. I'm not sure what I've made of this book. I think that when we do have a restored character, although we have holy fool troubles, I'm more interested in the book at the beginning when we have to put up with that sort of writing school pastiche bawdy in which women talk about their thing and there's much giggling going on. Did you have trouble with the giggling and the things?
Not too much. I think we've been spoiled by books like Hawksmoor, which are incredibly good pastiche, and workmanlike pastiche no longer satisfies us. There are things that you can't read over with any satisfaction. When you have blips and bleeps in supposedly 17th century discourse, it's as if, the king is eating pot noodles. I mean, it does not work. But I found that there was space in this, that in spite of the fact it takes a little trench of time, which had been fairly thoroughly excavated by Pepys at the time, that it did find ways sideways, even within the character. The character was a comic and ridiculous one, but did have a depth and a growth that did carry me along.
Like a lot of the characters in these books, oddly enough, he's a servant in bad faith, and he has to come out of that service and find his own life. And although, like you, I had problems with the lingo at the beginning, I actually became rather touched and interested in the restoration and transformation of this Merivale character. I like the way he moved from all that frightful garish colouring to the quiet brown drab.
Did you believe in the colouring? Did you believe it was?
I thought that it was fanciful and interestingly done. Yes, I don't know about believing as was it real. I thought that she had decorated this book well.
It seems to me that the reference to the 17th century just hurts the book. I would rather it had been set in some mythical place.
Like the one he makes up, like his imaginary brushes or
Yes, rather, because it's too worrying, all this, because you've got to prop at the marrying of the king's mistress to the vet that looked after the king's dogs, but not the king's horses, which was the big job, and the giving of the garter to the vet and so on. None of this is typical of Charles.
What about the nudging in the ribs to constantly to remind us that this is a book actually about Thatcher's.
Well,
Thatcher's
I think
England.
She's trying
the
that.
Poor, the poor sleeping in cardboard boxes.
And the magic word commission and
But in
so
dealing
on.
With details all the time, I think we ought to give her the benefit of an argument. I do think there is an attempt at an argument, which is that this is a sick society which needs to have a purge. I think there is a sense of the great fire as a kind of purging of this self-interested society.
Now,
I think, yes, I'm sure that's what she's up to. I think it's rather simple, actually, but I think
I
it's
don't know
quite,
what society would be well. I don't think I've ever read a book about a well society.
Let's do an even sicker society in John Bamble's book, which I, with others, enjoyed very much indeed. Though I suspect here that the sickness is all, in a familiar sort of way, inside. We're in Thomas Mann, Camus, Dostoevsky, Nabokov territory here.
Strange thing.
But very, very, very powerful and individual, nonetheless. I thought.
The odd thing is that the two Celtic books, if you can call them that, the Kelman and the Banville, are trying to do, I think, respectively, a nausea and an outsider, in a way. They're very much reaching for, curiously, existential emotions that have had their course in English British literature. But I thought this was wonderful from the moment the murder was done. I didn't believe anything leading up to the murder. I didn't believe anything set outside Ireland. And there's a bit where he borrows money from somebody who borrows it from somebody else and has his ear cut off. And I thought, you can't do spaghetti western, don't try. But from the moment he gets home and the moment this murder is committed, from then on, I thought the moods were extraordinarily beautifully evoked, none of them simple. And the surroundings began to come in. And you began to think that he was writing about evil in its inert, self-sustaining form, which is one of the phrases.
But I find it so odd that this self-engrossed, dreadful poseur of a man is so rightly in this document. I mean, I realise the game it's being played. It's a fake document, and it's not really being written by the man in his prison cell or whatever. But usually in that kind of writing, you do get a sense of a point of view that you are expected to take vis-à-vis this man. And this may be manipulated in the course of the writing so that you come to an understanding of your shared guilt with him or something like that. And in this book, it seemed to me that it was a crash shot on the end of a lens.
I thought the ugliness of the nature of the man and the kind of powerful writing that we get from him are clearly related. I mean, that is a mind in a particular disturbed state that's seeing those skies.
I don't think it's a problem. I think he invokes Dostoevsky at one point, and it is, you know, to have a sensitive criminal, after all, is quite a literary tradition. It does go back to Raskolnikov. I think the thing about this acute perception of landscape is that he feels himself always not at home in it. So there are these wonderful moments always in the book of turning away, like when he goes back home and says, before such scenes as this, I always feel like a traveller on the point of departure, that he's always about to leave the scene that he's in. So you have this marvellous sense of alienation all the way through. My problem with the book is I find it very alarming and chilling. It seems to me an extremely cold exercise, and the killing of the woman, and the killing actually of all the women.
Lots of killings of women, aren't there?
Lots of killings of women, which are
in Acte Gatouille, isn't it? That's
it's
where the Camus comes in.
Trying hard to be. But I'm glad because the basic equations don't satisfy me. That is, that this man is not human until he commits murder, and then somehow he enters humanity by the very act that in theory excludes him. That I don't find basically satisfying,
except
so I'm glad there was so much beauty of perception and cadence.
But the book actually undermines that sureness as well at the end, where the policeman says to him, what is true of what he's written down, he says only the shame. And then the whole book suddenly shifts again.
So all the evidence undoes itself. So you're not sure also whether you're reading an Oedipal story, because it's very much about the death of his parents, about his parents, his revenge on his parents, or also whether you're reading yet another political allegory about a violent and divided nation. Because one of the things about this man is that he's an Anglo-Irish inheritor of that failed politics, and the person he kills belongs to the rich, seething mass of ordinary Irish people.
Let's save this one for allegory. And let's go to Ishiguro. If we want allegory, let's go to Ishiguro, which is a pale view of the remains of the butler, or whatever
is
it's called.
A hint of some sort of that.
This is the favourite, of course, and has been well tipped all year. And
lost it.
Anybody who read the earlier reviews of the Ishiguro would have spotted that this was going to be the one that had to be on the list. I have to say, not to be perverse or obvious here, that it does strike me as really the turkey on the only one that I think ought not to be on a short. I think it's poorly written. I think, you know, very, very basic lessons in how you put a sentence together, what ugly sounds are to avoid and so on, aren't learned. I think the plot's transparent. I think it's bad. It's written with bad faith. And it's no. I'm just suggesting where I stand, more or less, on the book. And it's a bit like reading a bottler from upstairs downstairs. Hermione, how?
Well, no. I think you're simply.
You don't think it's upstairs downstairs.
I think you're simply making use of the fact that this book has had extremely good reviews, and it seems rather unfair to then set him up as the fall guy because he's been much praised.
No, I'm not doing that. I am describing
what
I think
you're
the book is.
You're not doing that. He's I think been very justly praised. It seems to me. No, I mean, not all good things are big. I think that this is a small masterpiece. I think
it's not the smallness I complain on.
I think it is immaculately written. Mm. I think it's an immaculately professional book about an immaculate professional. And what Ishiguro thinks about the butler is that he has to totally inhabits his role, and that's what's wrong with him. So this is an appalling story about self-castration and repression. And in order to write it, he totally inhabits the figure of the butler. That seems to be an extraordinary thing to have done. Very original.
But that's just its intention. Brilliant. You were just describing its intention. I mean,
no,
of course,
I'm describing my reading.
But that in itself is quite a smug thing to do, to occupy exactly the narrow trench of your character, to stay there for 240 pages, to only the faintest gleam of emotion cross.
He makes you feel
it.
What's wrong with it, and he makes you deeply
well,
feel
you know what's coming.
You slapped over the face
really
with what's wrong.
Do you really think he does that? There's one thing that gives the game away, which is that it is even supposed towards the end of the book that Miss Kenton would have been happier if she'd married Mr. Stevens.
Yes.
It's a preposterous suggestion.
Yes.
Mr. Stevens has proved himself incapable because, apart from the fact they've done nothing but bicker.
Miss Kenton, we should say that Miss Kenton is the housekeeper who is sort of throwing herself at the butler, but the butler doesn't know. But by God, we know.
I think this is an extraordinary piece of work because, to me, it seems to be like the most exquisite imitation of a novel.
Yes.
It does all the
or
right
of a novella,
things.
In fact, because a self-betraying narrator, there can only be one point at which we realise how far from his image of himself he actually is. You can't stay on that point forever.
Oh, but there's more than one story in here. There's also, I'm sorry to keep on about political allegories, but there is
the Nazis.
You've been reading the papers
the
today.
Tell me, Stevens, don't you care at all? Good God, man, something very crucial is going on in this house.
It's set in the year of Suez. It's set in 1956. It's set at the last point at which English people believed in what their rulers told them.
They never did.
Well, I think that there is a kind of caricatured version of an English political scene where you do what you're told and you trust that things are being run for you. And there's a lot about that trust in the book, and I think he does that terribly well.
Tremain, you live in England. Does this sound like a description of English to you?
If you're going to write a novel about England, you choose this rara avis called a butler. I mean, it's a fantasy idea anyway. It seems to me that it's almost as if he's setting out to prove that the English are as hidebound and hierarchical and given to meaningless submissions as the Japanese. And surprise, surprise, Lord Darlington turns out to be a Nazi supporter. I mean, it was so obvious.
Yes.
We trundled towards that.
Yes.
And in the end, although I can see it as an extraordinary tour de force, and it is not written in language all the way through. I mean,
it's not written in language.
Mrs. Simmons was, as a matter of fact, a frequent visitor to this house before the war. Indeed, she was amongst the most popular as far as the staff were concerned due to the kind appreciation she never shied from showing.
Dreadful, and it's all like that.
I won't take this. The point is that he writes as a stuffy, costive, pompous, rather boring
imitating
person.
His master.
And I think what comes through amazingly through that rather sort of formal, often quite awkward style, is an extraordinary sense of more than he is aware of.
But I didn't believe at all, and everything seemed to me to fall apart, the point when he's called upon to impart the facts of life to the son.
Yes, yes.
Somebody,
yes.
That seemed completely impossible socially. But it was humour of the wrong sort.
That's called humour. That's the joke. That's what the critics say. We laughed and laughed. Can we go on to our final novel by Sybille Bedford? And I guess we have to raise the old question right away. Is it a novel or is it an autobiography? And does it matter? Tremain.
Well, I mean, if this qualifies for a prize as a novel, then so did Daddy We Hardly Knew You, because I did exactly the same things in that as she does here.
You should remind us of what that is. Is that by Martin Amis or Julian Barnes?
It's my book about my dad. And the thing is that it's not written as a careful biography of my father with footnotes and documentation and so on, which means I can make up conversations, and she makes up conversations. I can present characterizations rather than doing some sort of, you know, attempt at a summary of what other
people... You're getting an interview on your book out of this.
Quite. But the thing is that it's... if it is a novel, then novels can be much less invention and much less artistically controlled. It's full of score settling. It's full of revisions of the historic record. When do we do that in novels? It's full of saying, well, you know, Aldous Huxley wrote about this scene, but this is what really happened. And the real argument against it, in my view, as a novel, is that the most important characterizations are not made. And the one that is really not made is the one of the person called Mummy all the way through, whose name one can barely remember.
I'm amazed that you say that about the mother. I thought that the really wonderful thing about this, not a novel, was the mother and her marvellous stories, which are interruptible and full of wit and full of a kind of zany wisdom.
We get told about them, but we don't get told them.
No, but you have a very strong sense of what she's like. And I think that the one of the things that I found moving in this book is that it's a pre-feminist argument about what it's like all those heroines in Jean Rhys and Catherine Mansfield and Elizabeth Bowen who wreck their lives by giving their hearts
away. You could argue that that's probably the trouble with it, that it reminds you of those.
I liked that because there's an argument about it, which is, do you do that? Do you, you know, you go slumming on the Riviera, as it were, and you look out for the next thing that happens to you and you have adventures? Or do you have a rather sort of costive, moral, keeping yourself to yourself, self-preserving kind of life as a woman, which there is a woman in the book who does that. And I think that argument is very interestingly taken on board by this young narrator. So it's a making of her as a woman.
See, I don't believe it, because I think if you love someone, you remember their jokes. And although her mother was full of jokes, she doesn't remember a single one. The mother is constantly... The thing we are told about, you see, is not really how wonderful the mother was. It's how much she loved her mother. And I beg to doubt it, because most of the evidence she produces against her mother is not of that kind at all.
The point is that she doesn't make the right... I mean, that she didn't really understand a lot of what was going on in her mother's life. She calls it an unsentimental education.
Yes.
With a nod at the float.
Yes.
And she is quite tough and unsentimental about this, about the things she got wrong.
And hence, Jigsaw, you do piece it together.
But the problem
is that you know what the design
will be. Yes, that's the danger of Jigsaw. Yes, too much of it is pre-understood.
Yes, yes.
In some ways, she's too wise. There isn't tension in this material that will suddenly surprise her.
An absence of tension of the kind that you would expect from an autobiography, in truth.
But it's not fiction, but it is fictionalised. That's the problem, you see, because if it's not fiction, you have certain responsibilities to your material. But if you are making it up, then you do put speeches into people's mouths. It's the David Plant approach to biography.
It's funny, isn't it?
I think with David Plant, we have to. Our time is up, and we have now reached that period where we have to choose our little winners, and also play guessing games. So can I ask you each which you would like to win, and also which you think might win? Tremain.
I came to this decision very slowly. I had difficulties with all the books, but I thought the one that actually struck the deep note, the still sad music of humanity, in the end, was Cat's Eye, was Margaret Atwood.
And do you think the judges will get that right?
They might. You never know your luck. I think it's going to be hard. I don't think it's going to be an easy one this time.
Hermione.
I think the Atwood's going to win, because I think her time has come, and I think the makeup of the personnel of the judges might sway it in that direction. If I were a judge, I would be tormentedly having to choose between the Banville and the Ishiguro.
Provocative. Adam.
I like the Banville. I have a soft spot for the Tremain, and I think the Ishiguro has been overpraised, but all of us in this room have been overpraised and can't wait for it to happen again.
Speaking as somebody who himself has never been overpraised,
right.
Can I say that I would be perfectly happy if the Margaret Atwood or the Banville won. I think justice would be done either way. I suspect they're going to pick the Ishiguro, because that's what judges do. Anyway, thank you all very much. And now back to the Guildhall.
Howard Jacobson, thank you very much. So there you have it, the late show panel in decidedly combative mood and also in complete disagreement about a worthy winner. And who that winner will be, we will know in just a few minutes.
as the chairman of the Booker, Sir Michael Caine, is about to invite the chairman of the judges to announce their decision.
It is now that I ask everybody to pay attention to the chairman of the judges, David Lodge, who is going to move to my right to announce the winner of the 1989 Booker Prize.
Where am I going to stand for the last link? Where am I going to stand for the
back
last
on your mark. Right, yeah. Okay. And you're going to be other down here somewhere, just out of vision. It'll be a good firm cue, okay?
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, each year's Booker Prize judges believe that they have had a uniquely difficult task, and this year's judges are no exception. Of the 102 books submitted or called in, 47 were nominated by one or more of us at the beginning of our deliberations as worthy of serious consideration for the shortlist. Whether this number reflects the unusually high quality of the entries or the unusual variety of the judges' tastes, I do not know. But I can tell you that our meetings were prolonged, intense, and anxious. Four of us are ourselves published novelists, and therefore have a good idea of the skill and imaginative energy required to compose even a modestly competent work of fiction. In the selection of an agreed shortlist, we were obliged to exclude many novels that were much more than competent, that were indeed outstanding, and gave different members of the panel, in different combinations, enormous pleasure. But such is the nature of literary prizes. Certain themes seem to recur in many of the novels we read: crime and punishment, bereavement and its aftermath, alienation and breakdown, possession by and exorcism of the past, moral and political choice in public life, speculation about the origins of our universe and the end of our planet. Some of these themes appear in the six shortlisted novels, but explored in different ways and very different contexts. What the six shortlisted authors have in common, perhaps, is their success in finding an appropriate style or voice through which to express an individual sensibility as it interrogates its own past, present, and future. In Margaret Atwood's Cat's Eye, a woman painter with a pin-sharp memory, looks back nostalgically, but not sentimentally, on her childhood and adolescence in a Canada that was more innocent but also more repressed than it is in the knowing, materialistic 1980s. In John Banville's The Book of Evidence, the perpetrator of a horrible and unprovoked murder relives in vividly eloquent prose the nightmare of his act and the black comedy of its sequel, and struggles in his Dublin prison cell towards some redemptive self-understanding. In Sybille Bedford's Jigsaw, a woman writer in assured possession of her style, treading the shadowy boundary between fiction and autobiography, evokes the comedies and tragedies of a way of life both bohemian and bourgeois, now vanished like the unspoiled Côte d'Azur of the 1920s and 30s where it is largely set. In The Remains of the Day, Kazuo Ishiguro's aging, exemplary butler, motoring through the southwest of England in the 1950s, recalls, not always reliably, the professional triumphs and personal crises of his life in service before the Second World War. The scrupulous dignity and restraint of his style imply the strengths and the limitations of the code by which he's lived. In James Kelman's A Disaffection, we're back in the present, the language of this novel oscillating between a ribald vernacular and a self-mocking parody of educated speech, mirrors the stresses and contradictions of the principal character's plight, a Glasgow schoolteacher cracking up under pressures both public and private. The irrepressible hero of Rose Tremain's Restoration traces the ups and downs, both moral and material, of his life in the reign and under the direct influence of King Charles II, in a droll, moving, sensuous narrative that brings those exciting, dangerous times to life without a hint of tushery. Six fine books. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've listened to this speech, or something very like it, on two previous occasions, and I therefore have a pretty good idea of how the shortlisted authors are feeling at the moment. I will not keep them or you in suspense any longer. The winner of the 1989 Booker Prize for Fiction is Kazuo Ishiguro for The Remains of the Day.
Wonderful things.
Great, thanks. Do I say something? Oh, yes, okay. Well, like everybody in this position, I have a list of people to thank. So may I start by thanking, well, mainly the people sitting at the table over there. That's my agent, Deborah Rogers, Matthew Evans, Joanna Mackle, and Edison of Faber and Faber. A special thanks, I think, for my editor, Mr. Robert McCrum, and my thanks to my wife, who's been very anxious all evening, Lorna McDougall. Now, there is one key and distinguished figure involved with the history of this prize who is not able to be with us this evening. The Booker Prize has been proud to affirm the literary quality of Salman Rushdie's work in past years. I think it will be improper for us not to at least remember him this evening and to... and to remember the, and to think about, I suppose, the rather alarming significance of the plight he is in this evening. Thank you very much. Good evening.
So, Kazuo Ishiguro has won the 1989 Booker Prize for Fiction. Perhaps not a surprising decision because he was a consistent favourite during the betting, and no doubt there'll be some who call it safe, but it was one of the most acclaimed novels this year in terms of its reviews, and there'll be many people applauding the decision. From me, from the Guildhall, with live coverage of the 1989 Booker Prize, good night.